Mr. Minister Sikorski, in your speech to the Polish parliament yesterday, you said Putin's only hope is our lack of determination. And what exactly is the West lacking in resolve?
Well, initially there was some reticence as to mm-hmm. what types of weapon and what type of support we could render Ukraine. We are now doing much more, all of us, mm-hmm. than we were ready to do at the beginning. And that's in response to the cruelties of Bucha, to the bombing mm-hmm. and rocketing of Ukrainian cities. Mm-hmm. I think the West as a whole, European Union and the United States, have overperformed in this emergency.
Okay.
Ukraine is fighting more effectively mm-hmm. Than I would have expected 3 years ago. Whereas Russia has underperformed.
Mm-hmm. But the German Chancellor still doesn't want to supply Taurus cruise missiles. Does that show the lack of resolve you were talking about?
I rely on you to change his mind. when the facts change, we politicians change our minds. You know, in my previous role, I was chairman of the delegation for relations between the EU and the United States.
Yeah.
In the European Parliament, and I visited Washington just after the Russian invasion, and at the Treasury Department, when I told them that we should confiscate Russian assets, they told me, never, impossible, we're not in the state of war with Russia, this cannot be done.
Mm-hmm.
And now the US is actually in the lead on this issue.
Yeah.
They've changed their mind. So I'm hoping that, like on other issues, the Leopards and others, that Germany will do more of what it is already doing. We appreciate mm-hmm. the fact that Germany, in absolute terms, has done a great deal to support Ukraine.
Mm-hmm. But coming back to this Taurus thing, do you think he will change his mind?
You have your politics,
okay.
We have ours.
Yeah, okay.
I hope the Chancellor is encouraged by the events of the last few days.
Mm.
The United States has supplied long-range missiles to Ukraine, the famous ATACMS with a range of 300 kilometers.
Yeah.
And I hope your Chancellor appreciates that it's a response to the Russian escalation, which is drastic. The Russians have knocked out already 70% of Ukrainian electricity generating capacity.
Mm-hmm.
This is actually a war crime. I mean, even in a war, you're not supposed to attack defenseless cities mm-hmm. and civilian infrastructure. And you know, we are talking, there was a conference in Berlin about rebuilding Ukraine
mm-hmm.
after the war.
Yeah, right.
Well, how about preventing it from being destroyed?
That sounds good.
I think that would be better.
Yeah. What do you answer people who say the Germans are just simply too cowardly or simply naive? What do you answer them?
Look, these are emotive terms that I wouldn't use. As I said already, at the beginning, I think some Western European politicians thought that maybe this was a mistake from which Putin could be persuaded mm-hmm. To withdraw.
Mm-hmm.
I think we now all know that Putin only responds to pressure.
Yes, right.
To the hardest arguments mm-hmm. of raw power. We were warning you about Nord Stream and about mm-hmm. Putin. You didn't listen then. I hope you listen now.
Well, that's a kind of naive then, right? Don't listen to you.
Realism about Russia seems to grow the closer you are to Russian borders.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And we all need to prepare more, all of Europe, for this aggressive neighbor that we have.
Mm-hmm.
We were all hoping that Russia would choose the path of modernization.
Mm-hmm.
Germany, under its presidency of the European Union, mm-hmm. proposed a sort of pact for modernization, if only if had been implemented, particularly on the Russian side, Russia would be a different country today. You know, we were negotiating a partnership and cooperation agreement too. And then Russia, around about 2011, chose a different path, despite our best efforts of embracing post-Soviet Russia. It chose an alliance with China against the West. We didn't want this, but we have to recognize reality.
Minister, we sat down with Ukraine's president 2 weeks ago in Kharkiv. You mentioned it, how the Russians were attacking or still attacking civilian infrastructure there. And I asked the president, why does he think there is no Taurus delivery from Germany? And his answer was that he thinks that Scholz told him that it's about Putin's nuclear threats, so that there are threats and that Scholz can't deliver Taurus because of that. Can you understand the Chancellor's position?
Well, thank you for another invitation to interfere in your internal politics, and I won't do that. But I will comment on the nuclear stuff, because I think it's easy to deter yourself by being unrealistic about what Putin's options are. So, first of all, we have zero indications that he's preparing to use nuclear weapons. We would know in advance if he was preparing to take...
There were reports lately about that, saying that Putin was thinking about it. There was a New York Times report about it.
I don't know how you report about what Putin is thinking.
They were actually discussing it, like back in the days when Ukraine was successful.
There are no physical indications of warheads being taken out of storage. Okay, we would know in advance if they were doing that. Remember, there are two types of delivery mechanism: intercontinental ballistic missiles, and then the tactical battlefield. Short-range warheads. And there is absolutely no indication that there is any movement on that. And then remember that these are very difficult to use, because the Russian army is not prepared to operate in a contaminated environment. These are short-range weapons, so you would have to use them. You would have to take your forces away from the front line. That would be immediately noticed and taken advantage of. It would be a political disaster for Putin. Russia would be completely isolated vis-a-vis China and India. Remember, if Russia used nuclear weapons, China's neighbors would go nuclear, Japan, Korea. It would have very grave negative consequences for Russia.
But your arguments are very rational. I mean,
that's what we try to do.
Yeah,
but is Putin?
Yeah, exactly. But is Putin as rational? Like, I mean, the discussion about using them was during a time, end of 22, when actually Ukraine took back a lot of territory, when Ukraine was successful in Kherson area and Kharkiv area. And, of course, before that, defending Kyiv. So if Putin would get even more under pressure...
Putin has annexed parts of Ukraine, including Kherson. He is now bombing Kherson. So by his definition, he is bombing a Russian city. So, in fact, he should be nuking himself. And seriously speaking, these are not weapons that he has under the push of the button. There is a normal Ministry of Defense and General Staff line of command to use them. Okay, so he would have to persuade his generals to carry out such an order. Those generals would know that to carry out such an order would be to become a war criminal. At that point, they would have a choice, either to carry out such an order or to get rid of Putin.
So you don't think it's a realistic scenario, or is it just a threat he's using to... Because if I talk to German politicians and in the past 2-3 years or the past 2.5 years, I think he actually, you know, this discussion actually was very present also around the Chancellor.
Well, I also know, this has been in the papers, that the United States has told Russia very firmly that if they were to explode a nuke, even if it doesn't hurt anybody in the outer atmosphere or over the Black Sea, the United States would use its conventional forces to destroy every Russian target in the occupied territories of Ukraine. I think that's a powerful deterrent. So this is a legitimate discussion, but it should not be used an excuse.
So we shouldn't be afraid because of that?
These are difficult calculations to make. The United States has obviously, or the United Kingdom has, and others have made difficult, different calculations from what you tell me is the state of play in Germany.
You got to know Vladimir Putin during your first term as a foreign minister. What was Putin by then? How was he?
He was very well briefed, I have to say.
Yeah.
He had a kind of CD-ROM of information as regards gas exports and oil strategies. And in particular, the most controversial subject between us at the time was the base that the Americans were then planning to do and are now finishing building in Poland for missile defense. They were threatening us with nukes on that issue too, so much so that while in Moscow, I had to ask publicly on Russian radio, would Russian generals please threaten us with nuclear annihilation no more often than once a month. And then they stopped.
You were particularly angry with a current German president in those days. You sent a lot of texts at X about him. Do you remember?
Actually, we had a intense but interesting discussion. I value my relationship with President Steinmeier. It was a discussion about what to do with Russia. What is the nature of the Russian regime? But more particularly, what is the historical paradigm that we are in? You know, we enter history backwards. We look for comparisons as guidance. To what we should do.
Yeah.
And his argument was that we are in 1914. We mustn't precipitate war by accident, by overreacting to provocations. My paradigm was 1938-39. We mustn't let an aggressive dictator be encouraged.
Was it that was before 2014 even, right? Your discussion
was around about 2014.
Okay, around
it was around about Crimea. And for some years I thought that actually that Frank Walter was right, but I think now I've been vindicated, unfortunately.
He wasn't right very often, even with this Iran stuff, I have to say. But after these experiences with Scholz and especially with Steinmeier, is there anything you really like about the Germans?
Well, look, I spoke in the Polish parliament yesterday saying that democratic Germany is our main trade partner, is our key ally both in the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, but also that the Weimar Triangle, together with France, we hope is a key forum of coordinating and arriving at pre-decisions. I hope you noticed my jab at our Europhobes, where I asked them, well, look, given how connected we are economically, do you really want a recession in Germany? Would this really be good for Poland?
Yeah.
And given that our exports mm-hmm. over the last 30 years mm-hmm. have risen 25-fold.
Wow.
Right? Mm-hmm. Do you really want on the ODA mm-hmm. what the British got themselves on the English
yeah.
Channel,
yeah, right.
which is the return of a trade barrier?
Mm-hmm.
I hope some of those arguments get through to them.
So what you hope is that we are able to learn, right?
Look, my argument, I mean, you know what Germany did to Poland during the Second World War,
yes,
right? But
yes.
we can either be, you know, bound by that forevermore. And my argument is just because we had, you did horrible things to us in the past doesn't mean that we have to be enemies for centuries.
Mm-hmm.
The Polish-German relationship is more mixed than some people think.
Mm-hmm.
If I may do some crypto advertising here, I
mm-hmm.
wrote a book that's been published in Germany called The Polish House, about restoring an old manor house
mm-hmm.
Which was inhabited by German families for about 70 years of its
mm-hmm.
600-year existence. The relationship is more complicated. You know, many words, if not the majority, to do with crafts in the Polish language, Wasserwaga, come from German. Many words to do with local self-government, Burmistrz, Burgemeister, come from German. And this is not an accident. We fought against each other many times, but at the Battle of Leibnitz against the Mongol horde, we fought on the same side. Unfortunately, we lost. On the other hand, at the gates of Vienna in 1683, Poles and Germans fought under the leadership of the Polish king, and we won.
Talking about winning in terms of the war now in Ukraine and Russia's aggression, what does Ukraine need right now, from your perspective, to win that war? Because more and more people are thinking that Ukraine can't win. We see that Russia in the past days, had success in some villages around Donbas and Avdiivka. So it doesn't look good on the battlefield right now.
Wars are never one way. The tide and flow of war is usually changes over time. And as your theoretician of war, Karl von Clausewitz, would say, there is always fog of war. There is always
mm-hmm.
uncertainty about what's actually going on. So last year, Ukraine recovered 50% of the previously occupied territory. This year, the Russians have regained the initiative. But what I think has not been noticed sufficiently is that Ukraine actually won the Battle of the Black Sea. Putin tried to blackmail Ukraine, Europe, Africa with the stopping of the passage of ships. Ukraine is now exporting almost as much grain as before through the Bosphorus.
But if you're, I spent a lot of time in Ukraine in the past 10 years, but especially after the full-scale invasion happened. And when you talk to people there on the ground, when you're there at the front lines and talk to soldiers, I see more and more people saying, we don't know how we should be able to take back all the territory. What was, you know, said by Zelensky, that this is still the goal. Do you believe that Ukraine can retake back everything, including Donbas, Luhansk, and Crimea?
Look, I wish the American package had been passed 6 months ago. And I wish we were supplying Ukraine with more Patriot batteries and the rockets for the existing Patriot batteries. With long-range weapons, you can hit precisely command centers, storage capacities, logistical centers, so that the Russians can't bring the force actually to the front line. And yes, Russia is a larger country, has a greater demographic depth. And Ukraine also has politics.
And Ukraine has problem of mobilization right
now. That's what I'm referring to. Yeah. You know, they could have done the mobilization law earlier too. But Russia's resources are not limitless, and Russia is not invincible. Defeated Napoleon and Hitler, but they did lose the Crimean War. They lost the Russo-Japanese War. They were knocked out of World War One.
But there's right now.
Let me finish. they lost the war in Afghanistan in the 1980s. I was there, and they lost the Cold War. Wars end in all kinds of ways. Sometimes by conquest. Sometimes through economic collapse. Germany. Lost World War One through economic collapse.
You just mentioned you were a war reporter back then. So you spent some time in Ukraine in the past 2 years. If you would be there now at the front line and talking to politicians, if you were a journalist still, how would you analyze the situation if Ukraine can win?
Russia has already spent more than half of its national reserve fund. This war is costing them tens of billions. Our sanctions mean that they've lost their most lucrative market for their oil and gas. They're now having to sell them at a discount of 30% and more, and for rupees, to India and China. I would expect the Russian economy to show signs of real stress in a year or two.
But that's what politicians said 2 years ago, that our sanctions would work, that Russia would be isolated, that you know they will
and
get huge problems.
Are working, but sanctions never work immediately.
But if you see if you see the Russian growth in the past months and years, and still do business with India.
Be careful with those numbers. When instead of a motor car, you produce the tank, which then goes to the front line and gets destroyed, your GDP has risen because economic activity has risen, but the wealth of your country is destroyed.
Time is running now. How can Ukraine win before Donald Trump possibly becomes president again?
Well, first of all, Speaker Johnson has allowed the package to be voted on, and I didn't hear any protest from Donald Trump. So I hope the candidate Trump has seen that this opposition to helping Ukraine is not actually popular in the United States, that it's harming his chances. Donald Trump was right in urging us all in Europe to spend more on defense.
That's right.
And Donald Trump also sent Ukraine anti-tank weapons before the war when others were not doing it. So it's not as black and white as some people comment.
I'm afraid of, that he weakens the NATO with how he's talking about it. You aren't?
Well, thank you for the invitation to now criticize our most important ally, which you know I cannot do.
I'm afraid of that.
but I'm glad that some allies, including Germany, are now increasing their defense budgets. Mm-hmm. Poland spends the biggest proportion of GDP on defense in NATO, including the United States. Mm-hmm. We are at 4%, and we might go higher next year. For us, it's an existential issue. And when I hear your defense minister. I'm glad that the scale of the challenge is at last being appreciated.
So if we see what Macron just mentioned in his speech, I mean, he warned in his speech yesterday, and I quote, "Europe can die." Do you believe that too?
Of course, every large group of states is never forever. And yes, we are being challenged by someone who wants to destroy the West, ideologically, but also geopolitically. Divide us from the United States and divide us from one another. And this is an adversary that doesn't respond to arguments or international law. We are the largest economy on earth. We should not be helpless. We need to. I mean, it was nice consuming the peace dividend after the Cold mm-hmm. War. Okay, but we overdid it, all of us.
And
we not only. And Poland less than others. We've been spending a solid 2% of GDP on defense for the last 15 years. Okay, but what happened in Western Europe was not just disarmament. Has been disindustrialization in the defense field, and this has to be undone. So the money from your special fund needs to be spent. Let me finish because this is really important. I'm grateful to Chancellor Scholz for releasing. Fund the European Peace Facility, 5 billion euros for this year alone, and also that we were able to jointly agree to spend money on ammunition and on upgrading our defense industry capabilities. We need to do all this urgently.
Do you think that Russia will attack Poland?
Well, Russia has attacked Poland many times in the 500 years of our history, so we wouldn't be surprised at all. Russia would then lose, because as the West, we are far more powerful than Russia. Today, Ukraine is not fighting alone, and unlike many times in the past, we wouldn't be fighting alone. But can you guarantee to me that Putin will not attack any NATO country?
But how big is a threat from your perspective? Because we have big discussions in Germany in like how many years Russia would be capable of attacking NATO countries.
Yeah, I took part in that discussion at the Munich Security Conference where I'm on the board. And German politicians seem to be satisfied that Russia won't be ready for 4 to 5 years and by then Germany will be ready. But the point is that Russia, before she gets to Germany, there are some other countries. And I will say this to you. In the beginning is always the word, as the book says. Before attacking Ukraine, Putin was telling us that he would do that. His July 21 essay, in which he described Ukraine as an artificial country. Okay. He and his and the former president Medvedev now call Latvia an artificial country,
mm-hmm.
and there is a sizable Russian minority there. These threats we can no longer, or more precisely, you should no longer take as just crazy talk, because they've just proven that they are capable of acting on these crazy ideas.
So you're ready mm-hmm. for an attack anytime?
No, the Russians have had to withdraw troops from the Kaliningrad exclave, thereby, by the way, proving that they don't expect NATO to attack them, that they recognize that NATO is a purely defensive alliance, because otherwise they wouldn't do it. Sure, they can't defeat Ukraine at the moment, so they're not ready to attack us. But we shouldn't assume that things will go our way.
So, but one more thing. Mm. If Ukraine is successful if Russia is successful in taking more land, taking more territory, taking more cities, mm. going more west in the direction of Poland? What about Poland defending inside Ukraine? Would you be ready to send ground troops?
I won't speculate on that. I'll first of all tell you what I said yesterday in my speech, which is that we have a choice. Either having a defeated Russian army outside the borders of Ukraine or a victorious Russian army on the border of Poland. And what Putin would then do is what Hitler did to Czechoslovakia. He would take the industry and the people of Ukraine and mobilize them to go further. You know, half the German tanks that invaded Poland in 1939 were actually Czech. So if Putin conquers Ukraine, he will be more powerful and the challenge for us would be bigger.
But that means so sending ground troops makes sense from your perspective.
So it's better to stop Putin in Ukraine, 500, 700 kilometers east of here.
You are meeting your German counterpart, Annalena Baerbock, next week. What do you think about her, she names it, feminist foreign policy agenda?
Well, we actually have a majority of women both in the HQ of the Polish Foreign Ministry and at missions abroad. I think we've just named one of the important rooms in the ministry after a Polish pre-war female journalists. I think at work we are all human beings. There should be absolutely no discrimination.
This is a special kind of policy then?
And I've just approved the priorities of Polish foreign aid budget. And they are strengthening the role of women in Africa and Asia, where women are free and prosperous. Usually the men benefit too. I mean, war is war.
This is what,
But it's not the only content on foreign policy. And in many other areas, I think it makes perfect sense.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Yes. Thank you.
Dziękuję bardzo. Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Pleasure.
Thank you.
Goodbye.